Can I hear me? Okay, so first of all, thank you for organization and say that it's my honor to present that the cryogenics. And yes, and in fact, I'm quite nervous because Yuri gave us excellent theoretical beauty talk, but my talk is some kind of dirty factor experiment. But anyhow, so yeah. So let's start. And okay, that's abstract my talk. And so, okay, so we adapted the cryogenics, I mean the cool mirror, to detect the gravitational wave. But why? Of course, there are some merit. The strong merit, strong motivation or merit is, of course, reduction of the thermal noise, as Levin, as Yuri explained. But I would like to show that the other ones. And then I would like to explain the actually how to cool down the mirror. It's not so easy task, anyhow. Okay, that's the contents. As first I talk the introduction, then next I talk about the thermal noise and as a merit of the cryogenic technique, and I explain the how to cool down actually, and I summarize my talk at last. And I have to finish the 12:30. Yeah, okay, so I will do my best for our lunch. Yes, okay, so that's okay. As an introduction, I just show that the list of the cryogenic interferometric gravitational wave detectors. There are two categories, the constructed one and the actually all of in Japan. And the first one is the Curio, that uses a sapphire mirror and the baseline length is only 400 meters. And the second one is the Kagura, this is also a sapphire mirror, and that arm length is 3 kilometers. And there are other future plan, and that's a Voyager, and that's the United States of the Silicon Mirror, and actually they use the LIGO current facility, and audio, Professor Audio in explain something in the afternoon. And more about that, European colleague who considered that Einstein telescope, that's the silicon and 10 kilometer, and also United States, and that's a cosmic explorer with silicon in the 40 kilometer, but I think that Michele explained in this afternoon. Yes. That's a good question. It still exists, but unfortunately, nobody take care so far because main Curio member also main Kagura member, so they are so busy. But of course, some people would like to restart again, but unfortunately, they have no time. But that's a lack of human resources as usual. But I would like to emphasize that at least the cryogenics is some kind of dream of the future, but actually it's not true. That's a real one. For example, that's a Curio photographs of full Curio, and yes, there are two papers in the physical review letters. And okay, nowadays that's a Kagura sapphire mirror suspended, as likely. This is a sapphire mirror. And you cannot easily show, but there is a white line. That's a sapphire fiber to suspend the sapphire mirror. And moreover, there are four sapphire mirrors, and three of them are cooled down already. And the last one will be cooled down within 2 weeks. So all sapphire mirror will be cooled down soon. And moreover, the commissioning with the cool mirror is in progress. And in fact, there are engineering run of the 3 kilometer cavity on the 8th of June, actually the Saturday of the last week, and duty cycle is more than 95%. Of course, it is a simple interferometer, but I think that's a good first step. And moreover, I would like to advertise something. Yes, and Fabian and Koki, the young Kagura collaborator, will present Kagura vibration isolation system tomorrow afternoon, so please never miss. Okay, that's the second section in the thermal noise. Yes, as I said, the strongest motivation to introduce the cryogenics into the interferometer is the reduction of the thermal noise. But okay, probably some of you think that's quite trivial, that's thermal noise. So if we cool down, that thermal noise should be small. But in fact, the story is not so simple. And that Yuri has already shown that famous formula and that energy equipartition theorem, that's okay, that's average of the square of the displacement is equal to the product of the Boltzmann constant and the temperature. Okay, so if t is small, that fluctuation is small. But we are interested, as Yuri explained, we are interested in the perspective density in the flexion region. And our observation band is between the 10 Hz and 10 kHz. But that average is integral of the power scale density in all frequency regions. That's too much for us. So we would like to concentrate at this frequency region. That's all. Okay, so we have to consider the power scale density. So, okay, that's actually the power scale density of the thermal noise of the harmonic oscillator. So you can easily find that, okay, this is an exact resonant peak. And I would like to introduce some parameters, Q value. That's the magnitude of the loss. And in fact, slightly complicated, but higher Q is a small loss. Okay, so if the Q value is high, that's the height of the peak of the resonance goes up. On the contrary, that the off-range thermal noise goes down. Because, okay, all frequency, that the integral of these power scale density, all frequency region is exactly the same as the product of the Boltzmann constant and the temperature. So that area is independent of the Q. So if Q value is high, that the resonance peak is peak becomes higher, so that's that part should be smaller. So higher Q is a small off resonance thermal noise, and it is better because we interested only the off resonance. We need not to consider the resonant motion in the case of the interferometer. Then, and moreover, here we assume that the Q value is independent of the temperature. In such a case, power spectral density in the all frequency region is small at lower temperature. So all frequency region, power spectral density goes down. But when we increase the Q value, that region goes down, but that peak rise up. So that's the difference between the Q and the temperature. But anyhow, we are interested in the off-resonance thermal noise. So the important thing is the amplitude of thermal noise of off-resonance is proportional to the square root of the T over Q. But that's exactly what Yuri explained. Okay, T is some kind of our noisy friend outside of that our room. So if our friend dies, so that's quiet. That room should be silent. But Q is some kind of the thickness of the wall. So if the wall is quite thick, and so noise caused by our friends never arrive at this room. So this simple formula shows that it's perfectly covered at what Yuri explained. But important things, if you check that this formula, okay, if t is small, that value is also small. But actually, as the Q value depends on the temperature. So we have to investigate how dissipation of Q value depends on the temperature of the cryogenic region. So that's the reason why I said that the story is not so easy. Anyhow, so I would like to show some famous example. Okay, as you know, as the room temperature, second generation interferometer, I mean that the Rigo and Virgo adapt to the future silica mirror suspended by the fused silica fiber, as like this photograph. Okay, so the simplest idea is we just assemble such a fused silica mirror with a fused silica fiber and just cool down. But unfortunately, this idea does not work so well because, okay, this is a show that how Q value depends on the temperature. Particularly shows the Q value, horizontal axis, temperature, that's the room temperature, and that's liquid nitrogen, liquid helium temperature. Okay, this black line shows that the Q value of the fused silica. Okay, that at room temperature, Q value is quite high, but unfortunately, it drops when we cool down the fused silica mirror. On the contrary, in the case of the sapphire and the silicon, that Q value goes up when we cool down that Q value. Such a material. So we can calculate the T over Q, and as you can easily find, okay, in the case of the fused silica, and the thermal noise at the low temperature is larger than that the room temperature, so it is perfectly useless. But in the case of the sapphire and silicon, yes, it obviously shows that okay, thermal noise at the cryogenic temperature is lower than, smaller than the room temperature. So that's okay. So important message is as follows. So we cannot use a fuse silica for cryogenic interferometer. So we have to use the new material, sapphire or silicon, and for mirror substrate and fiber to suspend the mirrors. Of course, so unfortunately, our expertise for the fuse silica cannot be used for the cryogenic. So that's a challenge. Okay, so I would like to, some noise of the interferometric gravitational detector briefly. And there are two kinds of the thermal noise, and that's a mirror and suspension. Probably that's just a repeat. I repeated that Yuri's explanation, but okay. Mirror thermal noise is something like this. So some kind of mirror is an elastic body, so it has an elastic mode. So that's elastic mode excited by the heat bath. So that's for mirror formula, mirror surface deformed, and so that's interferometer catcher, measure that such a fluctuation that, of course, interferometer cannot distinguish that that's a fluctuation or the gravitational wave. So that's a mirror thermal noise. And that's the suspension thermal noise. Okay. And in fact, there are two kinds of the suspension noise. First one is a pendulum. And so that mirror is suspended as like pendulum. So pendulum motion also excited by the thermal. So in such a case, mirror never deformed, but the center of the gravity of the mirror moved. So that's okay, that's also fluctuation catch by the interferometer. And moreover, that's some kind of bio remote of the wire. So that's such a standing wave occurs in the wire. So in such a case, the mirror also shakes by that vibration of the chatter thin fiber. That's called a bioremote. And so that's a power spectrum, and that's a frequency, and that's a power density. So that's blue line shows the mirror thermal noise. And that's green line shows that suspension thermal noise. And so, okay, mirror thermal noise could dominate the noise around 100 Hz. That's the most important frequency region. And below the 100 Hz, suspension thermal noise could dominate it. And moreover, we have to, that's a peak is a violin mode. So we have to take care that such a peak. And so, okay, so I would like to start the explanation of the thermal noise of the mirrors. And in fact, yes, of course, we have to take care of the dissipation in the substrate of a mirror, but we have to take care of the coating dissipation. And in fact, nowadays that's some kind of common sense. No, everybody says that the coating mechanism, coating thermal noise is a crucial point to develop the gravitational wave detector. But in fact, 20 years ago, nobody take care of the coating thermal noise because coating is quite thin, and four order of magnitude of the thickness of the coating is four order of magnitude smaller than that of the mirror itself. But 1998, Yuri pointed out the coating thermal noise could be an issue, and actually that's an issue. So that paper perfectly changed our understanding of the thermal noise. And okay, so more about so we have to consider the loss in the substrate and the coating. And moreover, we have to take care of the two kinds of the loss, and structure and thermoelastic. And structure is some kind of unknown frequency independent dissipation. We know that many experiments show that such a behavior on the many material, but nobody knows why. Anyhow, so we measure the Q value, and that's a base for the calculation of the thermal noise by the structure damping. And the second one is the thermal elastic. And this is the thermal kind of the coupling of the temperature fluctuation and thermal expansion coefficients. Okay, so the, for example, in the temperature of the mirror is not actually the constant. Some part, some point, some part, temperature of some part raise up, but other part, temperature of the other part is becomes small, lower. And so, remember that, that the mirror has some expansion coefficient, so that the fluctuation of the temperature causes some kind of deformation of the mirror itself. So that's the thermal elastic, thermal noise by the thermal elastic damping. And fortunately, we can calculate some that thermal elastic noise. I mean that if we know that the equation motion and the equation of the thermal conduction, and we can calculate perfectly. Of course, I never say that it is easy calculation, but some clever guy can calculate. So so we have to check that two kinds of the thermal noise. So actually, so we have to four kinds of the loss have to check for the mirror thermal noise. Structure damping in substrate, thermal elastic damping in substrate, and the structure damping in the coating, and the thermal elastic damping in the coating. So I explained each by each. And but so first topic is structure damping in the substrate. But that's again, I showed this graph, and that's how Q value depends on temperature. And so we can calculate thermal noise by the structure damping in the substrate. We just call the substrate sub-Brownian noise. In such a case, so silicon and sapphire has a smaller substrate Brownian noise, but fused silica has no hope. And okay, so we can calculate the thermal noise by the thermoelastic damping in the substrate. The reality is something like this. And okay, and so okay, I did not explain in detail, but if you check the carefully the formula of the thermoelastic damping in the substrate, and you remember that some kind of the theory of the temperature dependence of the material property, and you can easily find that on the high frequency region, this noise almost independent of temperature, but probably, roughly speaking, the 40 over 50 Kelvin, below the 40 over 50 Kelvin, and the temperature depend on the strongly, that noise depend on the temperature strongly, the power is 2 over 5. So, and moreover, so there's a silicon has interesting key features. Okay, here, and not so clearly, but here, that's this noise perfectly zero, perfectly zero, because at these temperatures, the thermal expansion is zero. So that's the reason why that this thermoelastic noise drops around this temperature. And so next topic is the structure damping, the coating, and as Yuri emphasized that unfortunately coating has a large contribution to thermal noise than we expected 20 years ago. So he shows that, okay, this noise proportional to the phi, square root of the phi. Phi is the loss strength, and actually it's the inverse number of the Q value. And so first measurement of the mechanical loss of coating at the cryogenic temperature was conducted by me, and that's a result. And later, the many group reported the result. And actually, my result showed that my result does not show the strong temperature dependence, but other group showed that some of the peak around 20 Kelvin. So, speaker is me, so let's assume that, okay, phi is independent of the temperature. The temperature, and so some case the amplitude of the 20 Kelvin could be slightly larger, that's a graph, but okay, that's a black line shows that how coating brown thermal noise by the structure damping is a coating depending on the temperature and the power spectral density. So yeah, something like this. Yes. You mean Jatsang? Yeah, probably. Yeah, many people think that it has a peak, but to be honest, that's my personal opinion. But I wonder what's caused such a difference. And so, in fact, Glasgow people come to Japan and they join that our measurement. But we find again that our coating loss is almost independent of temperature. So for me, yeah, the mystery is not solved yet. So I would like to solve, but not yet. Anyhow. Yes, and at last some noise is a some noise by the thermoelectric damping in the coating. We call the some optic noise, but that's here. So actually, that some optic noise is much smaller than the coating brown line noise. So far, we don't care. So I would like to summarize of that mirror thermal noise. Okay, that graph shows the case of the sapphire mirror. Okay, so at the room temperature, the substrate thermoelectric noise dominated. But and when we cool down, that noise almost independent temperature, but 2, 3, 4, 5, below the 50 Kelvin, it suddenly goes down, and around 20 Kelvin, and it's smaller than the coating Brownian noise. So, and more about around 20 Kelvin, and the thermal noise is almost 10 times smaller than the room temperature. So, probably that the 20 Kelvin operation is enough for us. And okay, I also calculated the silicon case of the silicon. And just similar, but I would like to emphasize that around 120 Kelvin. At this region, that's, let's say, the thermoelectric damping, thermoelectric noise disappeared. So that's also some kind of sweet point. But I have to say that, okay, temperature control is necessary. In the case of the sapphire, if the temperature, if temperature is 10 Kelvin, nobody cares. But if in the case of the silicon, if temperature is something, if silicon mirror is too cool down, that the thermal noise becomes larger. So some kind of temperature control is necessary. Anyhow, so okay, that's summarize. So okay, so that's some of the candidate of the mirror substrate and operation temperature. And okay, the Curio and Kagura adapted the sapphire at 20 Kelvin. Einstein telescope adapted the silicon at 10 Kelvin. And Voyager and the Cosmic Explorer silicon on 120 Kelvin. So actually, that's Japan, Europe, and that's United States. So now Latin America has some casting board. Yes, and okay, so before, okay, so now we know the operation point, but in such a in any case, so we have to take care of the heat absorption mirror, is mirror, because okay, there we use a high power laser, as explained in yesterday, so that mirror is a high quality mirror, but somehow that its mirror absorbs the laser power, so that temperature could be larger. So we have to avoid that the mirror could be hot. And it depends on the case, but the typical heat absorption in the mirror is roughly speaking between the 1 watt and the 10 watt. Okay, so we consider that in the case of the 120 Kelvin operation of the silicon. And in such a case, the colleague of the Voyager and the Cosmic Explorer said that, okay, we assume that heat absorption in the mirror is several watts. So in such a case, radiation from the mirror is effective. I mean, when we mirror is surrounded by the cold wall, cold wall, we call that radiation sheet, and detail explained later. that's cold wall in such a case, there a mirror emits some radiation, and that radiation carries a heat. But that's so effective, and because if we assume the black body radiation, and that power is 13 watt per square meter, and surface of mirror is 0.3 square of mirror, so probably that's 4 or 5 watt is possible, and so that's what actually balance that's several watt. Of course, and we assume the black body radiation case, so that sapphire emitter should be black actually. So we have to apply some kind of black coating on the barrel surface. And moreover, that's if that black coating introduces as a mechanical loss, and that could be a thermal noise. So that we have to take care of that. That the black coating has small mechanical dissipation. But I think this is not a serious issue. And so anyhow, so that's in this case, that's heat in generating the mirror escape by the radiation. So that fiber to suspend the mirror can be as thin as possible. I mean that the fiber, if fiber, I have to point it out, fiber must support the weight of the mirror. So, but if fiber can support the mirror weight, so it's okay. In such a case, typical diameter is 0.5 millimeter. And okay, so the case of the below the 20 kelvin operation, and in such a case, we assume that heat absorption in the mirror is about 1 watt. And but the heat extraction is some kind of issue because the radiation is useless because thanks for the Stefan-Boltzmann laws, radiation proportions are square of the temperature. So perfectly useless in such a low temperature. So that's the only way is that the conduction in the fiber. So generate in the heat in the mirror pass through that its fiber. Fortunately, sapphire on the silicon has an extremely high conductivity, something like this. But even in such a case, we have to use a thicker fiber for the heat conduction. In the case of the Kagura and the 1.6 millimeter in diameter. And I would like to repeat that if we need not to, if heat transfer is not necessary, the fiber diameter could be a 0.5 millimeter in diameter. Okay, so, but why I take care of that, the diameter of the fiber? Because the thick fiber introduces a large large pendulum thermal noise. Okay, so as Yuri explained, that the thermal noise connected is the energy dissipation. And energy of the pendulum modes is the summation of the gravitational potential energy and the fiber elastic energy. Fiber elastic energy is something like this. And it's also drawing by Yuri. And but okay, that's the pendulum. And if we check the closely in the end of the fiber, that fiber is bent. So here, there are concentrated elastic energy. So fortunately, gravitational potential energy has no loss, but unfortunately, elastic energy has loss. So of course, the thicker fiber has a larger elastic energy. It means that the thicker fiber has a larger loss, in other words, larger thermal noise. That's the point. And moreover, we have to consider some noise as a violin mode. And as I said, okay, violin mode is something like this. That wire vibrates, and that's so mirror should be checked. And that's some kind of back action with the fiber. So thicker fiber has a large back action, of course. And so moreover, the mode frequency of the violin mode is lower. Okay, so we consider that some noise of the pendulum mode as a violin mode, but okay, in such a case, we need to take care of the coating. And but we consider the two kinds of loss again, structure and the thermoelastic. And but I would like to emphasize both of them in the fiber is different from those of the three-dimensional bulk as like mirror. So we have to check again carefully. Anyhow. Okay, that's a pendulum thermal noise by the thermoelastic damping. And okay, that's a temperature and but some perspective density. Okay, so you can easily find that thermoelastic noise reduced drastically at the cryogenic temperature. it's fine. But, okay, if we consider structure dumping, and okay, so we assume that the key value of the wire is 5 times 10 to 6. In such a case, okay, below the 100 Kelvin, Brownian noise dominated. That's a problem. Okay, so we compare that Kagura, I mean the sapphire 20 Kelvin sensitivity with room temperature interferometer. That's the result, and okay, that's the black line shows that the total noise of the Kagura, and this dashed line and the violet dashed line shows that the advanced LIGO, and that's the blue line shows the advanced VAGO. Okay, at this region, okay, so mirror summonoid is smaller. Kagura mirror summonoid is smaller thanks for the cryogenics. Okay, that's Kagura summonoid. And actually, that the advanced LIGO and the VAGO are limited by the coating summonoids. So obviously, so Kagura summonoid is smaller. But unfortunately, in the disreflection region, the Kagura pendulum summonoid is larger because of the thick fiber. And I would like to point it out, and the bioremote of the Kagura is lower because of the, again, thicker fiber. This is a Kagura bioremote, and this is a LIGO bioremote. So obviously, that's a lower. And moreover, the 100, the sensitivity around the 100 is quite good, so not so good. Okay, so I will summarize the summonoids. And sapphire silicon 20 Kelvin case, mirror summonoid is small, it's great. But suspension summonoid is an issue because of the thick fiber thick fiber for the heat transmission. And so solution is something like this. First one is we construct the lower frequency interferometer with lower laser power. That's the Einstein telescope. And this is a gold sensitivity of the Einstein telescope. There are two kinds of the interferometer. The first one is a mirror temperature 10 Kelvin, and they use the less laser power. And on the contrary, the other mirror is a room temperature, and they use the high power laser. So, and that sensitivity combined, and so that's they got some excellent sensitivity in the all frequency region. And that's somewhat zoom up. And okay, the second solution is somewhat too ambitious, but small heat absorption mirror and large size thermal conductivity of fiber. And so if heat absorption mirror, not only the substrate but also the coating, is 10 or 30 times smaller than the current one, the fiber can be as thin as possible. But yeah, that's a challenge. Nowadays, substrate, small absorption, I mean a few ppm per centimeter, in small sample was reported, so it's not impossible, but of course, it's quite difficult for the large bulk, and the coating reduction of the coating absorption is also exactly a challenge, because nowadays, the coating absorption is exactly minimum. And okay, so other idea is a higher thermal conductivity of the fiber. But actually, we have to take care of the size effect. And this is the thermal conductivity is proportional to the fiber diameter. So this is some kind of limit of the thermal conductivity. And the phono mean free path is comparable with the diameter in the fiber. So it sounds like the upper limit of the thermal conductivity. But okay, if we consider the size effect, it is assumed that phonon is diffused on the fiber surface as like the molecule in the vacuum duct. Okay, that's a graph. That's explained that, okay, that's the wall of the fiber. And this is the propagation of the phonon. Phonon arrived at the end of the fiber, and that's reflected, but not the specular reflection. It's the reflected phonon can go anywhere. So this is like, as like the molecular in the vacuum duct. So the molecule attacks at the vacuum duct, and but the molecule perfectly forget direction. Direction, so molecule go away any direction. But if phonon reflection is specular, as like the light, the thermal conductivity could be larger. And in fact, thermal conductivity limited the thermal effect of the silicon is larger when fiber surface is polished. And this reported in 1969. So I hope that story also can be applied on the sapphire fiber, but I don't know. Okay, so that's the end of the thermal noise, but I would like to, I would like to explain that as a merit of the Kuru-Miller. So, but I show that two merit in the thermal length and the parametric instability. And okay, that's first one in the thermal length. And somebody asks a question that the thermal length yesterday, but I repeat some explanation. And okay, first, okay, that's a mirror, and we use a high power laser, so laser pass through the mirror. And so, of course, as I said, the mirror absorbs the laser light partially. And then, okay, so the temperature gradient appears. Okay, of course, that's the path of the optical path, and that part is the hottest part, but that part is not so hot. So there is some kind of temperature gradient. Then, so we have to take care of, okay, refractive index depends on the temperature. So that's center has a higher or lower the refractive index. It depends on the case. And but anyhow, that part, refractive index does not change so much. So that's optical length of this part is different from this part. So this is some kind of length. But unfortunately, in many cases, absorption is not uniform. So that's some kind of dirty length. So that's that lens disturb that wavefront. So some part of the laser propagate as a direction. And so that's got the worst sensitivity. That's a problem. And in fact, that thermal lens is a serious problem in the room temperature interferometer. So Ligon and Barbo guys, colleagues, so struggles and develops as a system to the compensate the thermal lens. long year. But how about the thermal lens in the sapphire below 20 Kelvin? And our colleague Takayuki Tomaru reported 2002, and okay, the magnitude of the thermal lens is something like this. Beta, beta is the temperature coefficient of the electrical index, and kappa is the thermal conductivity of the mirror substrate. Okay, if beta is zero, thermal lens is zero, of course, but because that's refractive index is independent of temperature. So even if that temperature in the mirror change, nothing happens. And if the thermal conductivity is infinite, again that thermal lens is disappear because infinite thermal conductivity means that no temperature gradient in sapphire. Okay, so we consider the he measures the beta and kappa in the sapphire and calculate that value, and he compared that value. He compared that value of the sapphire to that of the field silica. So he finds that this beta in the sapphire at 20 Kelvin at least 100 times smaller than the beta of the field silica room temperature. And moreover, the kappa is 10,000 times larger larger than that fused silica at 300 Kelvin. So in total, the magnitude of the thermal noise of the sapphire below 20 Kelvin is at least a million times smaller. That's quite impressive number. And so no system for the thermal lens compensation is necessary. That's good news. And but how about the thermal lens in silicon? I sent a colleague check, but I don't remember any report in the reports, the paper. So I checked by myself. And so in the case of the below 20 Kelvin, thermal length is negligible. That's fine. But in the case of the 120 Kelvin, I never say that it should be a problem. But less, I have to say that the thermal lens reduction is less effective. So anyhow, so temperature coefficient of the refractive index beta of the silicon at the 120 Kelvin is comparable with that of the fused silicon at the 300 Kelvin. So no gain of the beta. But thermal conductivity of the copper of the silicon at 120 Kelvin is 1,000 times larger than that of the fused silicon at the 300 Kelvin. So magnitude of thermal range is 1,000 times smaller. Of course, that's an impressive number, but in the case of the sapphire, that number is a million. So some, I think that some careful implication is necessary. Okay, the second merit is some kind of parametric instability. And somebody also asked the parametric instability yesterday, but I repeat again. Okay, there are some kind of elastic mode in the mirror, something like this. And there are also some optical mirror, optical mode in the cavity, something like this. So that's elastic mode somehow excited by the summary. That's vibration of the elastic mode excites the optical mode of the cavity. And moreover, that's optical mode cavity excited the elastic mode in the mirror again. So that's quite a positive feedback. Then finally, that's operation of the interferometer cannot be possible, impossible. That's a parametric instability. And in fact, I pointed out the parametric instability of the gravity interferometer is a less serious problem than that of the room temperature. There are two reasons. And the number of the unstable mode is smaller, and the more effective possible suppression of the instability is possible. It's okay, so the first topic is the number of the unstable mode is smaller. And the number of the unstable mode is proportional to the product of the elastic and optical mode density. And elastic mode density is inversely proportional to the cubic of the sound velocity. And so if sound velocity is large, that's elastic mode density is small, and so that's good for the parametric instability. And the sound velocity in the sapphire and the silicon is about twice times larger than the fused silica. So elastic mode density of the sapphire and the silicon is five times smaller. That's good. And how about the optical mode density? And in fact, optical mode density is smaller when beam radius is smaller. And in fact, larger beam radius is one of the techniques to reduce the mirror thermal noise. So if we adapt a gravity interferometer, we can adapt a smaller beam radius. So in such a case, the optical mode density is also small, and unstable mode, number of the unstable mode is also smaller. That's also good. And the second one is the more effective passive suppression of the instability possible. And okay, in order to suppress the instability, we adapted some of the passive suppression. I mean that we introduced some kind of loss on the barrier surface mirror. Actually, so that graph shows that figure shows that, okay, all barrier surface covered by some lossy layer. But actually, in the case of LIGO, they developed some kind of mushroom damper, and they put here, and that damper works well to suppress the parametric instability. Anyhow, so, but of course, such a dissipation introduces other thermal noise. But in the case of the cooler mirror, so now the temperature is quite low, so more effective suppression is possible. I mean that even if we introduce much more dissipation, and that then thermal noise should be small because temperature is low. And okay, so, so that's the last topic of the how to cool down actually. But I have to say that my topic is some kind of bias for the Kagura. Sorry, but I think that there are three points how to cool down. And the first one is the cooling bath or something similar is necessary. I mean, otherwise we cannot cool down anything. And of course, the cooling power is as large as possible. And the second one, the temperature after the cooling down is as low as possible. So I mean that, okay, if we have some heat load, except for the mirror absorption, that's temperature after the cooling down is high. So we have to eliminate any heat load. But story is slightly different in that if we choose at the 120 Kelvin operation. So in such a case, temperature adjustment system is necessary. But I skip this topic, but probably the afternoon speaker in the afternoon explain something, so it's okay. And so then the third one is the initial cooling time is short as possible for long observation time. So that's also a crucial point. Okay, so I explained that the first topic, the cooling bath, or something similar. So cooling bath means that somehow liquid helium or liquid nitrogen. That's excellent because they have a large cooling power, moreover they generate no vibration after cool down. That's great. So in the case of the 120 Kelvin, only liquid nitrogen is necessary. And so in the case of the liquid nitrogen, after we use a liquid nitrogen, of course it's a nitrogen gas, but who cares? There are a lot of nitrogen gas around here. So we need not to prepare any reuse system. So in such a case, in the case of the 120 Kelvin, we can use the liquid nitrogen. But in the case of the Kavra, the 20 Kelvin operation, story is different. Okay, we have to use the helium. And you know that helium is a quite important element. So we have to reuse. I mean that after we use a liquid on helium, of course that's a gas of the helium. So we have to apply the pressure on the helium gas and convert to the liquid helium. So it's also common cycle of the liquid and the gas of the helium. So we have to prepare the apparatus with high pressure. But in Japan, it needs some approval of the government and license to prepare and use apparatus with high pressure. Probably that's other countries in a similar situation. So more about the cost of such apparatus, I mean that the recycling of that helium is quite high, and the system is more complicated. So moreover, in the case of the Kagura, we constructed the interferometer in the tunnel, but liquid helium in the tunnel is not so fun. I mean that if something happened, we cannot breathe and we have to die. So Kagura, in the case of the below 20 Kelvin operation, we selected the cryocooler. But what is the cryocooler? So please remember that the heat engine in the lecture of the thermodynamics, and that's a hot heat bath, and that's a cool heat bath, and that's some kind of engine. And that engine gives that some kind of heat from the hot heat bath, and it gives a heat to the cold heat bath. But part of the heat, it transforms to the work. W. Okay, actually, that's some kind of cryocooler is some kind of reverse motion of that thermal engine. Okay, we apply the work W on this engine, and that's so that engine catch from the cold heat bath, and it pass that heat to that hot heat bath. So that's actually that engine gets the heat from that cool heat bath, and so the temperature of that cool heat bath becomes lower and lower. And I have to note that efficiency, the cooling power at the lower temperature of the cryocooler must be smaller because of the second law of the thermodynamics. So we have to never expect that high cooling power at the low temperature, unfortunately. That we cannot escape from the second law of the thermodynamics. Okay, so as I said, the cryocooler is some kind of reverse operation of the heat engine. So probably you have to face some test of the examination of the thermodynamics. In such a case, that's a famous figure of the thermodynamics, and that's a gas, and that's a piston, Okay, so in the thermal engine or cryocooler, that the piston moves. Okay, so usual case, the piston is quite rigid and heavy, so piston motion generates some kind of vibration. This is not so good. So we adapted the pulse tube cryocooler. I do not explain well, but this pulse tube cryocooler has some kind of virtual piston by the valve unit. And in fact, this virtual piston consists of the gas. So actually, that pulse tube cryocooler generates quite small vibration. And moreover, the cooling power of the pulse tube is roughly speaking, and 50 watt above 60 Kelvin and 1 watt around 8 Kelvin. Then, so Kagura adapted the pulse tube cryocooler. Moreover, we introduced a vibration reduction system developed by us. Okay, that's some kind of complicated figure, but okay, this part is a pulse tube cryocooler. This made by the Sumitomo Heavy Industry. And okay, that's top part of the pulse tube cryocooler called coil head. In fact, this generates large vibration, so that coil heater is fixed on the ground rigidly. I mean that, okay, this coil head is on the test table. This table is quite rigid, and moreover, that it's fixed on the ground. Then, and okay, that's the lowest part of the pulse tube cryocooler. Actually, that's the coldest part of the cryocooler. Then, okay, we prepare the cold stage. This cold stage is also fixed on the ground. I mean, okay, this is a cold stage, and this is a bar, and this is a, what's a vacuum chamber, and the vacuum chamber is fixed on the ground. And moreover, this stage, and this coldest part of the cryocooler connected by the soft heat links made from the copper. So, actually, even if this part vibrates, this part does not vibrate. Actually, the vibration of this part is comparable with the seismic motion because that is fixed on the ground rigidly. But thanks for that heat links, that part is also cooled down. This silent and cold part is connected to the target, which must be cooled down. Okay, so that's great. But what is the target exactly? And of course, you think, of course, that's a mirror or fiber, suspended mirror. But actually, we must cool down not only the mirror and the fiber, but also the first item is a cryogenic payload. In fact, if we cool down only the mirror, and we cannot control the mirror position and alignment. And control of the mirror position and alignment is definitely necessary for light interference. I mean that if we cannot realize the light interference, that we can never get the high sensitivity. But the detail explains the cookie tomorrow afternoon, so I skip the detail here. Then, okay, in fact, that's not the end of the story. And moreover, we have to cool down the radiation shield. And so that's some kind of schematic view. And that's a cryogenic payload. And this cryogenic payload in vacuum, but in addition, that cryogenic payload is surrounded by the cooled wall that we call the radiation shield. And if we do not use that radiation shield, 300 radiation directly attack the cryogenic payload. So that's the power of the 300 radiation. It's much, much larger than the power of the cryocooler. So that we need some of the cooled wall to protect that cryogenic payload from the 300 radiation. And okay, so we consider some kind of heat load. Actually, as I said, if any heat load should be eliminated. Otherwise, the lowest temperature is not so low, actually. But if you are familiar with the cryogenic experiment, actually, the extra heat load is always an issue. But in our case, largest one is 300 kilo radiation through the hole for the laser beam. Of course, this radiation should have a hole. Otherwise, the laser cannot arrive at the mirror. And then, moreover, this hole is comparable with the mirror itself. I mean that 20 centimeter in diameter. And 300 kilo radiation through the such large hole is about 20 watt. It is large, obviously larger than the cryocooler power around 8 Kelvin. So okay, that's quite an issue. So that's, at first we would like some kind of torque, as like this. Okay, we extended some kind of duct. That duct also called cooldown for the Kelvin. And so for mirror, that's a hole. Without this duct, that's a hole for mirror. Here is a hole, 300 kilo radiation hole. But in such a case, 300 kilo hole is here. Now actually, the power of the 300 kilo radiation is proportional to the solid angle of the hole. So in such a case, solid angle is smaller. So 300 kilo radiation should be small. But actually, unfortunately, the cryoduct can transmit 300 kilo radiation well. In this figure, we expect that, 300 kilo radiation attacks at this duct totally absorbed. But actually, this is not true. That unfortunately, this duct reflects 300 kilo radiation well. So 300 kilo radiation, something like this, something like this, and finally it attacks the mirror. So we developed some kind of cryoduct for the cargola, and actual case, and first of all, we applied a black coating on the inner surface. So that cryoduct can absorb the 300 kilo radiation well. And moreover, we put some kind of buffer to disturb the propagation of the 300 kilo radiation in the duct. So according to our result, and please refer to the PhD thesis, and only 0.1 watt radiation can pass this duct. So it's enough, small. And okay, so then we consider the initial cooling time. And again, it is always a serious issue in the cryogenic experiment. And the Kagura case, I would like to introduce the Kagura case. And there are 3 points. At first, initial cooling of the radiation shield. Otherwise, mirror cannot be cooled down. And next is the initial cooling of the mirror and its suspension. I mean that the cryogenic payload. And because it is isolated thermally, so it's not easy to cool down. And okay, so that's the story of the Kagura, but probably some of you would like to develop that's a better system. So I would like some comment for you to how to reduce the cooling time. Okay, that's first part of the initial cooling time of the radiation shield. Okay. In fact, the total mass of the inner radiation shield of the Kagura is about 700 kilograms. So that's all right. And typical specific feed is different. That law, that famous law, say that, okay, 1,000 joules per Kelvin per Kelvin at room temperature. And as I said, heat exchange power of the pulse tube cryocooler is 100 watts. We use that two cryocoolers. So, okay, so we can calculate how long is the initial cooling time. And okay, I calculated and initial cooling time from the 300 Kelvin to the 100 Kelvin is about 14 days. And okay, so probably some of you wondered why I don't take below the 100 Kelvin into account. Because, in fact, below the 100 Kelvin, the cooling time is quite small because of the small specific feed. And in some lucky case, we large thermal conductivity. And because, okay, so the reason why the specific heat at the cryogenic temperature is small thanks for the Debye model. Debye model say that specific heat is proportional to the cubic temperature, but I would like to emphasize that, in fact, this Debye model is a conclusion by the quantum mechanics. So, in fact, that's a small specific heat at the low temperature is some kind of effect of the quantum mechanics. So as Stefan explained, it's okay. Quantum mechanics is some kind of show that excellent interferometer figure, but in fact that quantum mechanics also predicts that there was some kind of behavior of the material property at the cryogenic temperature anyhow. And so, okay, in fact that one of the, our graduate student, Yusuke, conducted the exact simulation to evaluate the cooling time, and his result is fortunately consistent with my naive calculation, 14 days. So, okay, so next we consider the initial cooling time of the cryogenic payload. As I said, payload is isolated summary, so it's not so easy. In the case of the carburetor, the total mass of the payload is 200 Kelvin, and again, that typical specific heat is something like this. Then, and above the 100 Kelvin, we can use a black body radiation. And okay, Kagura payload has a total surface area of the Kagura payload is roughly speaking 1 square meter. And so in such a case, radiation power is 460 watt at most. I mean, of course, we need some kind of black coating, but in fact, we apply the black coating on the payload. So actually, the radiation is quite large. So if the payload is inside of the radiation sheet, suddenly the temperature of the radiation sheet becomes quite low, of course, okay, that's a payload and that's a radiation shield. And so, okay, suddenly that radiation shield temperature is absolutely 0 Kelvin. So in such a case, okay, radiation starts to cool down for the temperature of the payload. In such a case, in fact, it takes only one day to cool down the cryogenic payload if radiation shield suddenly cooled. That's great. But actually we know that, okay, it takes a time. It takes a time of 2 weeks to cool down the radiation shield. So it implies that temperature of the payload is follow that the temperature of the radiation shield while payload temperature is above 100 Kelvin. That's also our result. And this experiment shows that, okay, the mirror temperature follow, that marker shows that the mirror temperature, and this marker shows that the temperature of the radiation. So at high temperature region, and that the mirror temperature follows the radiation shield. That's good. And so if we selected the silicon at the 120 Kelvin, this is the story, great. But Kagura chose that the cooling, that the 20 Kelvin operation, so we have to cool down more. And but in fact, cooling of the payload below the 100 Kelvin is slightly difficult because, again, radiation does not work so well because radiation power is proportional to the scale of the temperature. So in the case of the Kagura, we use a heat link is a twist thin aluminum fiber, something like this, between the payload and the cryocooler. So fortunately, thermal conductivity aluminum is around 100 Kelvin, is quite high, something like this. But in fact, the denied heat link can transfer the only 1 watt heat power because we assume that mirror heat absorption is 1 watt. So that's the reason why we designed something like this. And moreover, we remember that the specific heat is smaller at lower temperature, thanks to the Debye model. And we know that typical specific heat are 100 Kelvin, 300 joule per Kelvin per Kelvin, and the total mass of the suspension is 1200 kilograms. So we can calculate it if the heat extra power is 1 watt, how long does it take the cooling time below the 100 Kelvin? actually get for 15 days. And that's the result also shows that, yeah, its cool time is almost 2 weeks. So, okay, I would like to show that how to reduce the cooling time. So, okay, so first of all, short cooling of the radiation shield is in any case necessary. And okay, fortunately, payload temperature can follow that shield temperature above 100 Kelvin owing to radiation. And the second part is a short cooling of the payload below the 100 Kelvin. And it's necessary to the, in the case, it's not necessary in the case of the 120 Kelvin. Okay, we discussed the first part, short cooling time and the radiation shield. Of course, we need much more cryocoolers. In fact, we use that in the case of Kagura, totally 4 cryocoolers. But of course, we can add some cryocooler, but of course, geometry constraint and more, but we have to take care of the vibration of the cryocoolers. And of course, we can use a more powerful cryocooler, but in such a case, we have to develop. And also, we have to take care of the vibration. And of course, and okay. Other methods to realize a short cooling time period below 100 Kelvin is, of course, we use a C kind of shorter heat links, but issue is external vibration external vibration transmission. Of course, if we use a C kind of shorter heat links, it can transmit the large heat, but it also transmits the large vibration. And in fact, even in the case of the Kagura, we need something like that. The vibration isolation system for the heat link, something like this. This is a payload, this is a sapphire mirror, and so that's a heat links, and this is a cold part, but this heat link is not directly connected to the payload itself, but we prepare some of the vibration isolation system here, and that heat links pass through that system. And actually, yeah, that's some kind of a schematic view, but the actual one is something like this. And in fact, that heat links has already been installed in the Kagura cryostat. And so, if you would like to use that C kind of shorter heat links, you have to develop a much better vibration system, something like this. yes. And okay, the next one is short cooling time for the payload below 100 Kelvin. And if you, some kind of, we can use a thermal switch. Thermal switch is something like this. In the phase of the initial cooling, thermal switch is turned off. In such a case, heat pass works. And after cooling down, we turn off the thermal switch. So heat pass cut. And so that sounds excellent, but thermal switch is quite tricky part. And for example, we can use a gas as a thermal switch. And okay, but in such a case, radiation shield should keep a gas. So, but you know that all force for the laser beam and the bar from room temperature are closed if we use a gas as a thermal switch. And during cooling, the main laser beam cannot observe drift of the mirror. And the super insulator absorbs the radiation shield absorbs the helium gas, and it takes a long time to evacuate helium gas. And there are some other trick for the thermal switch and some kind of mechanical one, exactly. A mechanical thermal switch between the payload and the cryocooler, but there are some large heat contact during the initial cooling and the chemical force, and large thermal isolation after the initial cooling, and the thermal switch on the suspended object, and so on. That's also tricky. So, okay, so I would like to, I have 15 minutes, but anyway, okay, I summarized my long talk. And okay, as I explained, there are the merit of the cryogenic interferometer and the comparison with the 300 kilo radiation interferometer. So there are three topics, small mirror coating thermal noise, small thermal range, and less serious parametric instability. But of course, there's some kind of challenge. And if we select the cryogenic interferometer, we have to such a challenge. We have to face such a challenge. We have to adapt the new material, sapphire or silicon, as a substrate of the mirror, and small vibration cooling path for cryocooler should be prepared. And we also installed the cryoduct to terminate 300 kilo radiation. And we have to realize a short cooling time for the radiation shield. And okay, so we consider the two kinds of the operation temperature. And in the case of the below 20 Kelvin operation, we can enjoy the merit fully. But we have to investigate, overcome some of these topics. Thicker fiber for the heat transmission, the heat link vibration isolation, and the cooling time below the 100 Kelvin. And in the case of the 120 Kelvin operation, since radiation cooling is effective, so issue below that 20 Kelvin, something like this, does not matter somehow. But unfortunately, some merit are missed, especially coating mechanical loss reduction is necessary. And okay, that's some kind of advertisement. In fact, if you are interested in the coating thermal noise, such a excellent books published on the 2012. Actually, Kenji Numata, my colleague, and I write down the cryogenics part, and Yuri also writes down the part of the fundamental coating formula. And that's all. Thank you for attention.